Our last panel discussion here is along the lines of the theme of this week, which is that all of us working together can help ourselves and others at the same time. Our next panel has companies who compete fiercely in the market: Alibaba, Tencent, Huawei, JD, Microsoft, IBM. They're very fierce competitors, but they also agree that working in open source together makes each of them stronger. And so I'd like to welcome to the stage the executive director of the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, Dan Kahn, who is going to moderate a panel on cloud native technologies. Please welcome Dan Kahn.
We're going to dive in here, and I'll introduce the folks as I ask them their first question. I do want to share with the crowd that this is a very intimidating panel for me, because almost everybody here is on the governing board of my organization, the Cloud Native Computing Foundation. So these are all of my bosses. But I'm still going to try and ask a few hard questions. Here, and I'm actually going to go a little bit out of order in order to shake this up. Let me start with Michelle. Loved your keynote yesterday. So you are on the Kubernetes steering committee, 13 people who run the Kubernetes project, and you're also the developer representative on the governing board. Do you hold those positions because Microsoft is a platinum member of CNCF?
That's a good question. You know, the Kubernetes Steering Committee, this was created based on an election that happened last year. And fun story, when I was deciding whether I got nominated and I decided whether I wanted to take that nomination or not, my coworkers were worried. They were like, you know, do you really want to take it? You don't have to. Don't feel pressured. So it's really refreshing that even though, you know, this would have been good for Microsoft, I wasn't pressured. No, it's not. It doesn't really have anything to do with that. I just really wanted to give back to the community that gave me so much, and I want to help make that a positive place to be for a long, long time.
And Michelle, I think folks remember from yesterday, senior software engineer at Azure, and co-lead SIGApps and Helm maintainer, as well as those other positions. Todd, you're the chairperson of the CNCF governing board,
yes,
and vice president of open technology at IBM. I'd love to hear IBM's perspective on hybrid cloud, where I think you're one of the few companies that actually has two different certified Kubernetes offerings.
Yes, and you know, from hybrid perspective, having so customers and you know our clients and developers, oftentimes in large enterprises find themselves with a need to deploy on-premise and not share necessarily out in the public cloud. But then they want the capability to be able to move workloads into the cloud, use the same tools, get the same skills, build up using Kubernetes, right? And so from our perspective, making that available is really important. And so, you know, we have a program of having a hybrid cloud where we have both the IBM cloud private offering as well as public cloud offering. And it gives people the best of both worlds and the skills that they need, you know, to be developed and used across the whole cloud infrastructure. So it's very important, especially to the enterprise, to have those kind of capabilities, especially when you look at the financial services industry or insurance, et cetera, where data on ground to them is key.
Great. Jack Tai, our new board member from Alibaba. Mm-hmm. Everyone, I think, knows Alibaba is the dominant cloud company in China. I'd love your perspective on Kubernetes here and what you've seen in terms of cloud native adoption here in China.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I think, you know, our containers and the microservice and the Kubernetes, they have been gaining a lot of momentum in China. That's why, you know, Alibaba Cloud also provides a full stack of cloud-native services to support this movement. Like we have the Kubernetes container service in our cloud, along with a register service that will support their distribution and the management of Docker images. We also have our function compute service in our cloud, which is probably a layer on top of Kubernetes, but they are all providing cloud native support for our customers. But even though these momentums are going on among the developer ecosystem, if we look at the revenue generated by the different services in our cloud portfolio, you will still see that elastic computer service, our cloud storage, as well as the relational database service, they are still among the top ones in terms of the revenue. But we also find that some users, some companies, they buy virtual machines from us. But inside of the virtual machines, they are still deploying containers and microservices, those cloud native stuff. So I think it will still need some time for the enterprise to switch to the ready-to-use cloud native services provided by the cloud vendors instead of building their own stack. I think it's probably some concerns about vendor locking, and that's why I think standard in this space will be very, very important. And I was chatting with Jim. I think Linux Foundation and CNCF needed to play an important role here, so that people will feel more comfortable to move to the cloud native service, instead of using the lower level service.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
Thanks. Hi, Fei-Lu, from JD.com. You are the vice president of the technical infrastructure department there, and JD is the newest member, platinum member of CNCF, and our first platinum end user. JD.com wrote a great blog post last year about your transition from OpenStack to Kubernetes. I'd love to hear how that is progressing and your thoughts on the size of Kubernetes in JD.com today.
OK， 我用中文来回答这个问题。实际上京东的基础架构，我们最早的整个的计算资源的管理是在 2014年我们2014年的夏天开始用 Docker， 我们直接从物理机没有经过 VM 的时代，直接用 OpenStack 去调度 Docker， 然后管理我们所有的计算资源。那么在 2016年1月份的时候呢，我们看到整个 Kubernetes 那时候虽然还不成熟，但它整个的设计理念以及未来它会非常的promising。 所以我们选择那个基础方向。在2021年1月份开始，我们开始搭建 Kubernetes 的集群，那么果断地从 OpenStack 加 Docker 向 Kubernetes 去迁移。那么经过2年多的时间呢，我们现在整个在线上的这个比例呢，大概还是以前 OpenStack 大概占 45% 左右，然后 55% 是 Kubernetes Cluster。那我们 Kubernetes 的整个的集群呢，它管理了实际上我们几个方面的内容。那对于我们电商的基础站来说，它负责了 在线的服务，这是第一个 tier， 也是机器最多的。然后后面整个的 middleware， 包括 cache， 还有很多 nearline 一些处理，也是用 Kubernetes 所托管的。那更重要的是后面 data layer 数据层的我们的 database 的可扩展的方案是基于 Vitess， 它也是完全是 cloud native， 它是基于 Kubernetes 的方案。那甚至我们目前这18年在做的是实际上是在做在线和离线的一个同步。 我们很多 big data 的 computing 正在跟在线还有一些 streaming 的 computing 去做充分的调度，那所有的一切都是基于 Kubernetes 来调度的。那我们 Kubernetes 整个的使用的话，大概跨越多个数据中心，然后大概有10几个集群左右。它这个整个 Kubernetes 所管理的机器呢，超过了我们公司所有机器的一半的这样一个份额。嗯，Thank
you。 And Andy Lai, you lead Huawei's cloud open source development team and are also on the CNCF governing board. I'd love to get your perspective on two of these questions. One was the hybrid computing that Huawei also has two different certified Kubernetes offerings, and then also your thoughts on uptake of cloud native in China and how that's progressing.
Okay, so to answer your first question, obviously, hybrid cloud is very important. I mean, from talking to our customers, especially enterprise customers, a lot of them already have private clouds and then they want to explore public clouds. And so we at Huawei, we believe having one architecture, one API, and that kind of architecture would be best fit for our customers. So hybrid cloud is definitely very important, and this is why we invest a lot in kind of a hybrid kind of R&D and contribute to the community. For example, Federation cluster, that's very key. And there are other, and also, you know, multi-networking, multi-storage, all these technologies can help our customers move into a hybrid cloud environment so they can be more efficient and they can save costs. And to answer the second question about the uptake in China, you know, the thing is containers is, you know, still pretty young compared to Linux. So there are a lot of different surveys, and I talk to developers, talk to users, and also I did some research on the survey. I think one of the surveys produced by China Information and Communication Institute, they just did a China survey of container usage in 2018 or cloud native. And so it's very interesting, the kind of deployments, container deployments are most common in China are either very large or very small, either less than, you know, 500 nodes or more than 1,000 nodes. So it's understandable that a lot of, you know, enterprises supported, sponsored by government, and these deployments tend to be large. So they have a lot of resources to, you know, learn new things and then adopt container technologies. And you get a lot of small startups, and they are more, you know, courageous and innovative, and they want to, you know, check out, you know, container and cloud native. And it's the medium ones that's slower, a little bit slower. And also the, I still think there's a lot of, well, according to this survey, the three biggest challenges are, number one, lack of understanding, and number two, lack of use case of, you know, cloud native, number three, security, right? So I really think that Linux Foundation, CNCF, are doing a great job, you know, producing the websites and then translating the material in Chinese, and then having events here is gonna help, you know, build up more education awareness. And I think that's really good. And moving forward, we really want to focus on building out use cases that people can really leverage. And so they'll, you know, I think that's gonna help increase adoption.
Well, great, thank you. And finally, Liu Qin, we just enjoyed your keynote. You're the general manager of the mobile internet group of Tencent, and also Tencent is the newest platinum member of our parent, the Linux Foundation. I would love your impression of cloud-native services in China today and how Tencent Cloud is helping it address the demand.
那我还是换一角度回答这个问题吧，因为我领导和管理的团队主要是腾讯内部业务服务，并不是腾讯云的团队，所以我很难替腾讯云去回答这个问题。那我想我可以通过腾讯内部的技术架构的演进去思考这个问题。那我们从2年半以前开始使用文化技术对我们的架构进行改造。那么当时呢，我们其实是考察了很多，考察了三个这个 Kubernetes 啊、Mesos 啊、Docker Swarm， 因为我们最终选择自己去做这个容器的管理和编排，自己去写这个容器管理的调度器。那后面呢，我们也成功的把我们所有的历史上的这个我们团队的历史的这个服务都迁移到容器上面来，而且实现了这个在线服务和离线服务的容器的混布，就是说我们的服务器白天可以运行你的在线服务，那么晚上就可以运行类似这个 Hadoop 的这个离线的计算任务啊。那在此基础上呢，我们也知道在腾讯有很多其他的 business group，他们也会用到容器技术，那么他们会去选用 Kubernetes 作为它的那个容器编排的一个基础。那我们在去年的时候，我们实现了在腾讯内部的一个容器的这个统一的调度，我们会把很多腾讯内部的空闲资源实现共享。那我们在做这个事情的时候，我们就会实现了各个 技术团队不同的这个容器端的技术的一个统一啊，一个统一的调度资源的调度啊，我们完成了这样的一个工作。那么我们在这个基础上，其实我们已经大概会有这个弹性的计算针已经超过接近有100万核的这个100万的 CPU 核的这个这样的一个弹性调度的能力在腾讯内部啊。那么这些服务呢，其实目前是给很多这种一线的任务，比如说人工智能的训练，然后图片和视频的这种一线的这个转码处理，提供了这样的一个很大的一个算力的这个共享的能力。那么我想通过这样的案例，我们可以看到，即使在腾讯这样的公司，其实要解决的这个就是技术问题、云原生的问题，就是所谓云原生的问题，我们要解决新技术和老的技术架构如何这个完善，如何结合，同时要解决那外部的开源项目和自己的技术发展如何完美的这个逐步这样的一个问题。我想这样的一个技术经验，那么如果用到现有的公有云和现有的这个企业的 IT 服务里面，我想这个都是一个很好的这个案例和参考。谢谢。
It really would be. That's fascinating to hear, and I was not actually familiar with how much Tencent is already adopting those cloud native architectures. It is interesting, though, that across a range of almost every large company, they've had to reinvent.This same container technology and try and deal with the same approaches toward scaling. And now with Kubernetes and CNCF, they're actually able to share a lot of that expertise. So this is a question for anyone or multiple of you on the panel. But you know, there's a term for China where people talk about the second mover advantage. Often say, people say, oh, well, it's better to come first.But in a lot of ways, the US and Europe wasted huge amounts of money installing, for example, fixed line telephones all throughout the country, where in China, because it's developed later, it's been able to move immediately to mobile phones and have a much more efficient investment. And I'm curious if you're seeing some of those same second mover advantages from some of the younger companies here in China that maybe have even skipped the whole generation of virtual machines and are able to move directly to containers and cloud native.
Yeah, I can go first. I think to me, it's less about the technology adoption centers because you know, in recent years, China has been catching up in technology so fast. If you look at two types of major users of cloud computing, one being the internet companies,and the other being the big enterprises. They have invested so much in the recent years in China too, and you know, their legacy status is pretty much the same as their counterparts in the Western countries. So to me, I think the difference really lies in the people. You know, people's mindset, people's skill, and people's self-image. And I think that's more important. You know, do you think you are a leader in the industry and you want to pioneer all the new technologies?Or you want to be a follower and see, you know, others going first and I'll follow that, right? So in that regard, I think most Chinese internet companies, as well as some pioneer big enterprise users like China Mobile, they have been so aggressively using cloud native technologies. While, you know, in general, the majority of their, you know, enterprise users, I think they are still lagging behind a little bit. But, you know, not so much, maybe 6 months. Yes.
I actually agree. I think it's going to be a mixed, you know, workload, right? Especially enterprises, they are more conservative. They still have legacy stuff. So they're still going to have a need of VM and bare metal for, you know, HPC kind of computing. For container or cloud native, they understand they have to innovate.So generally, when the customers, Huawei generally deal with large enterprise customers, they would have you know, investments in all of them. And they're definitely cloud native is very important for their 5G, you know, the future AI stuff. But existing data center transformation, digitization, I think VM and bare metal are still very important.
要
好，我简单用中文说一下。实际上在这个问题分两方面，第一个就是说在很多公司这是一个很有意义的一个启示，就是当那个技术浪上来的时候，我们有时候怎么样去弯道超车，怎么样后发先至，就是我们可以跳过上一个技术的浪潮，然后去选择下一波的一个技术手段。举个例子，就比如说我们以京东为例，我们没有用 VM， 我们直接用 Container， 用 Cloud Native， 用 NAS 等方式。但从另外一个角度来说，其实对于任何一个大公司，特别是对于今天中国很多公司，它技术发展非常的快，很多的公司啊，不管是 BAT、JD， 很多公司他们的规模也大，依然有很多 legacy 的一些 system 的，我们有很多遗产，有很多固有的原来的一些技术的手段和平台。那么在公司内部去推动一些变革，我想不管是对于腾讯或者是京东或者阿里巴巴很多公司都一样，就是特别是在 infrastructure 这个领域，我们去推动变革都是会遇到有很多很多的挑战，甚至有很多部门之间的壁垒，然后包括 infrastructure 向上推给应用开发者，这里面都会有很多很多的挑战。但我觉得在这个过程中，实际上Cloud Native 就 CNCF 这个组织实际上是它会起到一个非常积极的一个作用，因为它整个呢不光有 Kubernetes 这样一个旗舰的一个产品，它还有 Helm、Prometheus、Vitess， 包括后来很多很多项目，它实际上就会形成一个套件，形成一个 infrastructure 和平台的 platform 这样一个套件，成为一个事实上的标准。这个实际上是对于不管是对于中国、欧洲和美国很多的公司来说，对于整个基础设施的变革以及云原生整个这个努力，会起到非常大的一个作用，会成为一个事实上的标准。这也是就为什么我们很多公司，包括腾讯、包括京东、包括阿里，都会积极加入这个组织的原因。
I really appreciate that endorsement of CNCF, and I do want to emphasize that it's why I'm here in China, why so many of you are here, and I will mention it more than one time. It's why we're so excited to have our first ever KubeCon, Cloud Native Con.In Shanghai this November 14th and 15th.
We will be back.
One of the reasons that I was so excited to come to China in particular was because, you know, when we first started the special interest group SIG Apps in the Kubernetes community, I had reached out to some Chinese people and some people from Australia and had asked,should we change our meeting schedule to better accommodate your schedule? How can we get you involved? Because I know that you're looking at the technology too, and that was very early on. And the response I got was, you know, just record your meetings and we'll watch them, and please take good notes, and we'll read those, and we'll follow along. And in the recent past, I've gotten even more interest around engaging with the community.Some Chinese folks reached out and said, we'd like to demo at SIG Apps. We'd like to be more involved. And so I was so excited, and I am so excited to be here from a Kubernetes community perspective, just to see what you all are into and what you're doing and how we can actually get you more engaged in the community and what your needs are, because we want this part of the world to feel as engaged as possible.
Thanks.So CNCF is best known for hosting Kubernetes, and we describe it as an anchor tenant. But we now have 23 projects in the foundation, and more coming in. I'd love to get several of your impression on particular projects near and dear to your heart or your companies. And I might start with Haifeng, if you could mention Vitess.Because I think you guys have been some of the early adopters of that project.
对于CNCF 里面很多的项目来说，我觉得首先 Kubernetes 肯定是旗舰的项目，它是一个 flagship， 然后在我们公司它也是我们很多现在 infrastructure 的一个基石。然后另外 Helm 这个项目也非常 Helm 是 Kubernetes 一个 package management， 它是一个包管理器，它非常的灵活。它现在已经在我们公司内部占据了大概30%-40%这样一个上线发布的一个份额，啊，非常的好。对，然后另外我们非常运营规模很大的就是 Vitess 是一个之前有搜狗、YouTube 的工程师他们开发了8年的一个MySQL 的一个集群的解决方案，MySQL Scaling Solution， 实际上它非常的成熟。从我个人的技术评判来说，我觉得 Vitess 它是一个 提供啊 MySQL 集群啊，甚至 New SQL 这种 solution， 目前来说最稳定、最成熟、最 production ready 的一个方案，因为它能够兼容原来啊 MySQL 很多的啊 legacy 的 system， 它的底层它是用 MySQL 去做存储和复制引擎的，这个对于很多大公司已经有成熟的 DB 的团队来说，这是一个啊非常好的一个特性，因为原来的人的技能都会使用，而且啊 MySQL 整个的生态系统是非常强壮的。重新去 build up 啊 from scratch 一个新的一个 new SQL database， 实际上软件很好写，但是生态系统会非常难建立。而基于 MySQL， 同时用兼容 MySQL 做这样一个 new SQL 的方案，实际上是啊，它是一个比较好的一个工程上的选择。所以说从 MySQL 到 new SQL 到更可扩展的结构化的数据存储的这个过程中，我们在啊2016年的10月份就立项做这个事，实际上是基于 Vitus 的。这跟2016年一月份去使用这个Kubernetes， 他们俩有非常紧密的关系。这使得我们把最难调度的workload， 也就是 database， 对于一个电商公司来说，它的database 将是它最核心的数据资产。我能够把 database 变成云原生，就是我们真的运用了这种 cloud native database。这使得我们把应用cache、middleware、database， 包括后台的一些 offline 处理，能够统一的用 Kubernetes 去编排起来，然后真正做了统一的自由的计算，当然我们最近呢，今年年初我们也开始紧密的跟进和评价 SynthF 新的项目，比如说Envoy 是因为我们要做下一代的服务框架，就是SysMesh， 就是服务网格，肯定是第二个方向，这个方向是没有问题的。我们在积极的评估安网，那现在还不是生长环境去使用，我们也在对它做很多很多的优化。那主要是提升这个转发面，就数据面的性能，这里面也会用到一些内核的技术。当然，它跟容器技术紧密集成，我们需要用一些快速的包转发来提升它的性能。其实最终只要是能够把性能再提升一个台阶，最后这个我是非常看好这个安沃整个的设计理念和它的应用的前景。那现在关键的问题就是怎么样去优化性能。当然我还非常关注 SynthF 其他的项目，很多新出来的一些项目都会积极的跟进。然后我有一个小的建议，一个想法，也是我们团队一个努力的方向，就是我觉得 SynthF 现在很多在计算、在管理这方面的项目都非常的成功。它后面可以在补充和增强的项目应该是跟分布式的存储相关的，但是有 Vitus 这样一个MySQL 或者 NewSQL 的方案，但可能这个还可以再增强，比如说后面再有一些分布式的文件系统的方案，或者说一些NoSQL database 的解决方案进来，会让 SynthF 整个的一个技术的堆栈，或者说它整个的项目的版图呢会更加的丰满。这是我的想法，谢谢。
That's great, I think. So I look forward to working with you on looking at some of the storage solutions. I know Vitess is one of our newest projects that just came in this year, but to have a company in JD.com scale using it in production is a very strong endorsement for it. Now, Michelle, you mentioned Helm, so I wonder if you could comment on that and maybe just follow up on your keynote on it yesterday.
Yeah, so I've been working on Helm for the past 2.5 years, and it has been an incredible journey, and we're just so excited to be a part of the CNCF because we think that the CNCF has a lot to offer, and we've also been already taking advantage of the CNCF, so it just made sense. We started off as a Kubernetes sub-project. So if you go to Kubernetes GitHub org organization, then you'll see Helm. We're going to move that into its own organization on GitHub and start making some transformations and some progress there. Helm has just grown up so quickly, and there's a huge community behind it, and we're excited to serve that community and ecosystem even more. And also learn from Kubernetes. Kubernetes grew up really fast and has had all these scaling challenges and has gotten a lot from CNCF too. And so we've been seeing some similar patterns and kind of learning and trying to mirror that as well.
Helm provides a lot of value to the end user, and because of that, it really has come around really quickly. And that's a statement for us as well too. It's quite a useful tool, and anybody who's getting involved with Kubernetes really needs to take a good look at it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Well, if you look at the number of sessions at KubeCon for a non-CNCF hosted project, I think Istio definitely counts as number one. And it builds on top of Envoy that Haifeng mentioned. I wonder if you can tell us about IBM.
Well, and service mesh has become so important. To have to manage all of the different services themselves for security and logging and all the other things that you want to go and do to run that large microservices-based thing that you're putting out there and depending on is very difficult. And being able to centralize that with the type of capabilities that between Envoy and Istio and other projects related to that provide, you now take that into a central fashion and can much more easily control what you're doing. There's just tremendous value in that, and that's why we believe that the whole service mesh world is going to be something that we will all come together around very quickly as well too, because like Helm, Istio, and Envoy and other technologies just make it so much easier to operate and run at scale, and it's scale that really counts the largest of us.
I am going to add in one more advertisement that if you do want to hear more about Vitess and Helm and Istio, and of course Kubernetes and our other 19 projects that KubeCon, Cloud Native Con in Shanghai this November 14th and 15th is going to be by far the best place to learn about it. We're going to have simultaneous interpretation, not just for the keynotes, but for all the different sessions, both the ones that come through the call for proposals and also the project sessions run by maintainers. And I do want to give one more quick ad to say that the call for proposals for that conference is still open. It's run as a community conference. Any of your organizations that are playing with these technologies, that have run them in production, even negative experiences that you've tried it and you ran into certain bottlenecks or hurdles, we would love to hear about it. And so it's you can just search for KubeCon, but the deadline is July 6th. And we would love to get many, many submissions from Chinese companies talking about their experiences.
KubeCon Europe was a huge hit. We never had a group come together that big in Europe to go and spend any time on it. The technology has really taken Europe by storm as well, too.
We've grown from 500 people at KubeCon Cloud NativeCon 2 years ago to 4,200 and 4,300 in the U.S. and in Europe. And I do want to be clear that China is only the third conference that we're at because we're so focused on the opportunities here and working with the Chinese community, the Chinese companies, and especially end users. And so we really are excited to make a multi-year investment.
I'll just add real quick as well. I served as co-chair for the KubeCon last year and have a lot of experience reviewing CFPs, which stands for Call for Proposals. We really want to hear from you. If you want to ask questions about how to write a CFP or just want to chat a little bit about that, I'll be outside hanging out. I'd love to chat about that. And encourage you to submit.
And I think what's required for the submission is just an address, right? So it's
very short.
Yeah. It's pretty easy.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, unfortunately, I need to end the panel here, but I hope folks will come to Shanghai. I know many of you, or hopefully all of you, will be there. If I could just ask Todd to stay for a second, but thank you all to the rest of our panelists. That was a great introduction.